Twilight Zone, the movie. In one of the segments, they made a modern-day version of an episode of the Twilight Zone called It's a Good Life. A little boy named Anthony. Y'all remember him.
You're a bad man. You're a very bad man.
You think that? Go ahead, Anthony. I'm a very bad man. Keep thinking that.
Anthony could read people's minds and appeared to be able to bring about whatever he thought up. And the people in this town were terrified of this kid. One of the things he used to do was force people to be happy.
That's all the television there is.
Oh, it was wonderful, Anthony. Wasn't it, everyone?
Oh, that was real good.
Wasn't Anthony's television wonderful tonight?
Oh, it's just the best.
It was much better than the old television.
Much better.
He would force people to come together to have a community fun time. They used to have to think happy thoughts at all times.
I hate this house. I hate everything about it.
The modern day version of Anthony. He made a fake family comprised of people that he lured to the house, and when they got there, they found out that they couldn't leave. And they used to have to pretend to be happy at all times.
Mind the step.
Now, I don't think the movie told exactly how the family was tricked into coming there, but the teacher he lured there, he made her think that she hit him with her car. He made that happen. So he got up, told her he was all right, and she took him home.
How do you do?
Did I hear Anthony come in?
Yes, there he is.
This is my mother and father.
It's a pleasure to meet you, Helen.
She gave me a ride home, did she?
You don't mean it.
Oh, very generous of you.
All of them were captives. That wasn't his uncle. That wasn't Anthony's sister. That wasn't Anthony's mother and father. They were all captives that he found somewhere. Or he made them find him. Like he made the teacher hit him with her car. But right after Anthony brought the teacher home, they went through her purse, you know, because they was weird.
Mind the step.
That must have been the time that one of them slipped a note in the purse telling the teacher that they're being held hostage and that she was in danger. Right, and I'm going to get to where I want to be at in a minute, but it's about fear.
Great.
Do the hat trick, Uncle Walt?
Yes. Oh, yes. Where's the hat?
It's on the TV.
There it is. All right.
Come on.
Where do you
want to light it?
After the rabbit trick, the teacher flipped out, and that's when Anthony found the note in her purse.
I can make it real nice here. I can make the food just the way you said it should be. I can even change the house. Just say it and I can make whatever you like.
This is the monster. His name is Anthony Fremont. He's 6 years old with a cute little boy face and blue guileless eyes. But when those eyes look at you, you'd better start thinking happy thoughts.
So Anthony was pacing around asking which one of them wrote that note. Now, I'm going to call it shell-shocked, something that military people go through after being exposed to so much war. They essentially go crazy. Some of them become paralyzed with fear, unable to even move. And people say not to be afraid of what's going on these days, but me, I say that there's a lot to be fearful of these days. A lot. And fear is one of those situational things, or kind of like a dual-edged sword. Depends on how one reacts to being scared. Now, the bug that they let out on us. The COVID. For me, it's not really the bug itself. It's what they've used it for. The lockdowns, the social credit score, the eradication of basic human rights, the transformation of the normal into the abnormal, and making the abnormal into the normal, and all this other stuff we see going on. There's a lot to be fearful of. But for me, it's not the thought that one day I might be able to get pregnant. Hey, that's, you know, that's a question these days. They say that men can get pregnant. Like, what is a woman? So no, the most scariest thing to me about all this stuff is not me getting my first period. Because, hey, that's what they're saying too. They're saying that we can menstruate. That's what they're saying. And I heard that terrifies young girls when they get their first one, and they need it explained to them by mommy that it's a natural thing. But anyway, it's not any of those things. To me, the scariest thing to me about all of this stuff going on right now is this right here.
What?
Stay back.
Boy, you ain't got on no man, boy.
Stay back, sir.
Oh, you ain't got on no man,
stay
boy.
Stay back, sir.
Fuck you,
you boy. Stay back.
Fuck you.
Stay back.
What you gonna do? What you gonna
stay
do?
Right here.
What you gonna do?
Stay right here and defend
you need to get a fucking man.
I'm gonna stay right here and defend myself.
You're fucking yourself.
I'm not scared of you.
I ain't scared of you.
Stay right here.
You're scared to die or what?
I showed you gonna fucking die. What you say?
Right,
you need to get a mask, you son of a bitch. Fuck you.
Right, I'm not scared.
You in here fucking contaminating the whole goddamn store.
I'm here. I'm here. You sleep with that mask on 24/7? 7 days
a week. Let me make this clear to you, boy.
How they were able to turn the citizenry against itself, even more so than the divides that we already had. How people were called the unvaxxed and science deniers, categorized as the problems in the world and the ones holding society back and preventing everybody from returning to everyday life or refusing to take the cure. Blaming each other, like when Anthony found that note.
It was her.
Well, no, it wasn't me.
No, her, Ethel.
Oh,
Ethel.
Yeah, it must have been Ethel. Of course,
yeah.
It had to have been Ethel. That's right.
Yes, Ethel. There you are. It was Ethel. That's fine.
Oh, great. I'm wishing you in a cartoon land.
Jesus.
And it wasn't just the blaming each other for spreading the bug. It was just the overall manipulation and seeing just how easy it was for the few to do it to us. Further divisions down political lines, schools and school teachers, nurses and doctors, and all kinds of people at each other's throats over this bug. World leaders in a rat race with other countries to see who can secure more of the cure than other countries could, and who can get it first, and all kinds of flipping on each other. Not just the thing about refusing to take the cure. I told a story a while back when I was in Rite Aid.
I had the nerve to sneeze. I want breakfast.
People reacted to me like I came in to rob the place.
Yeah. Well, hey, I'm really sorry too.
Get a gun!
Let's get organized, fuck!
Like I had just pulled a gun out. People were moving away from me and all that. One lady, she put her child behind her like I was actually holding a gun in my hand.
Calm down, everybody.
I had a mask on and everything, and people still reacted that way, just staring at me like I just tried to kill them.
Come on! Wasting my time!
But people will suggest to not be afraid.
What's the matter?
We talk about fear-mongering. Fear-mongers. Sometimes they call it, sometimes they describe it as people spreading fear porn. People will say, don't be fearful. But me, I say, if nothing about what's going on scares you, then there's something wrong with you. That's just my opinion. Me, I see a lot of things to be scared of. And the scariest thing to me is how much more will the people, in the word of David Icke, acquiesce to the various things that they're implementing. That's the scariest thing to me. Will we just keep following the path that the few has set? The World Economic Forum, the World Health Organization, the CDC, and others, those are the few that I'm talking about. I call them the few.
Maybe he'll get mad at you, like he did to his real sister, and cripple you and take away your mouth so you won't be able to yell at him anymore. Or maybe he'll do to you what he did to his real mother and father.
Time for you to go now, Ethel!
Different groups of people try to secure their position with the same one that is holding people captive. And seemingly not realizing that this thing doesn't care for anybody, like what Anthony ultimately did.
I hate this house. I hate everything about it. I wish it away. I wish it all away.
Anthony? Where are they? The others?
I sent them where they wanted to go. Away from me.
People still searching for ways to not be in as bad of a position than others are. Like the I've already escaped the Matrix people. Something is wrong with them. They haven't went anywhere. They haven't went nowhere. Other people who are suggesting that people invest in the digital currency so not to get left behind in our forever changing world. In all kind of other ways, I still see people trying to one-up each other. Like how they talk about how immigrants are taking our stuff. You know, trying to stay ahead of others. In Anthony's house. Something else that's scary. I mentioned the erosion of basic rights. The Denver Airport mural. There are a lot of videos about that. Some of them are even documentary styled. The mural depicts an apocalyptic scenario, of course designed and orchestrated by the few. Mass extermination of the population, and even shows that all they want left are the children. And to be doing God knows what to them kids. But believe me when I tell you, the scariest thing to me about that mural, it's not even the being exterminated and the thing about the kids. Those things are frightening too, but the scariest thing to me is this part.
The second fresco in the Bank of America's lobby is an apocalyptic concentration camp where resistors are incarcerated. In the background, industrial burning suggests a crematorium. The back and side wall are strung with barbed wire. Hazmat Marines carrying rifles are seen in the crowd with their Nazi gold eagle and flags. Notice the person wearing the white hazard protection gear. The hazard protection gear symbolizes a pandemic, biochemical, or nuclear warfare. This is the same apocalyptic theme found in the Denver mural, in which the Nazi general is wearing a gas mask. Overhead, the elite are hovering and celebrating like gods, circling free and naked in their wealth and power. They are energized by the chaos below, where the world population is trapped in their net. All races and creeds are caught in the net of riots and protests, including a Catholic bishop, a nun, and a handcuffed man. The protest signs are blank, implying they have no voice.
With nobody can hear the crying out for help. The way they are attacking speech. Slowly but surely making all speech into a crime, and in conjunction with how people are still clamoring over each other for a cozier spot in Anthony's house.
And as we mentioned, another big story we're following, stunning police images just released, a warning that these scenes may be too disturbing for some viewers. The dramatic moments caught on camera when police in South Carolina found and freed a young woman held hostage by a serial killer in a storage container for months. ABC's Eva Pilgrim reports.
Tonight, the dramatic and disturbing new images showing the moment authorities walked up to the sealed shipping container where a woman was being held captive. Authorities using a saw and crowbars to break into the container. What's inside? Pitch black. Investigators armed with guns walk through, finding Kayla Brown chained up inside a crate.
How are you, honey?
The 30-year-old held prisoner for 2 months by an admitted serial killer. In the video, you can see Brown with a chain around her neck.
Just one. It's attached to a chain on the wall, and my neck's attached to the wall up here.
Wearing glasses, sitting on a makeshift bed.
Something straight out of Hannibal Lecter. Here's this girl chained up like a dog in the back of a container.
Authorities using bolt cutters to free Brown, who had been trapped inside the container on this property belonging to 46-year-old Todd Kohlhepp, a seemingly successful local realtor.
Imagine her crying out for however long she was in there, but nobody heard her. But imagine if no one ever came, no police or anybody else, or even worse, imagine it was the police who put you in there in the first place. I mean, you gotta know no one, you gotta know no help is coming then. Then you got the people themselves getting other people put in there. labeling everything hate speech. They don't even understand that their speech will be hate speech in the future as well. And they're going to have to think happy thoughts at all times.
That dog, that collie dog, he doesn't like me. He's a bad dog.
But I'll probably talk more about fear some other time in the future. Probably. Oh.